Our next paper is by Mr. Rosasco of Sun Company Incorporated, and he is talked to be on the dehydrogenation of isobutane on sulfided nickel catalysts.
Okay. It's better now. The work I will describe today is part of a program that we developed at Sun on the dehydrogenation of isobutane to isobutylene on supported nickel sulfide catalysts. But today I want to focus on two interesting aspects that we observe in this development: process of activation and deactivation, that both we believe are related to the process of coke formation. Let me explain you a little bit about the interest of this reaction. Until recently, lower olefins such as isobutylene or propylene were essentially obtained as byproducts in fracking process and in refinery operation. But nowadays, new opportunities are appearing for catalytic dehydrogenation as the market for oxygenates such as MTBE or even the polymers such as polypropylene has grown significantly. But the dehydrogenation of lower alkanes imposed really important challenge for the development of a catalyst, considering that in order to have high conversions or high equilibrium conversions, we need high temperatures, low total pressures, and low hydrogen to hydrocarbon ratios. You can immediately recognize that these conditions favor the formation of coke and therefore a rapid deactivation. For example, if we consider a typical dehydrogenation catalyst based on platinum supported on non-acidic support, the dehydrogenation kinetics usually follows this form: first order in the hydrocarbon, a negative half order in the hydrogen, indicating there is a competition for the same absorption sites between the hydrocarbon and the hydrogen. At the same time, the rate of deactivation at a given conversion is also very dependent on the concentration of hydrogen. And since usually the deactivation is directly related to the rate of coke formation, the rate of deactivation is usually inversely proportional to the concentration of hydrogen. Therefore, although these two rates decrease with the hydrogen to hydrocarbon speed ratio, the rate of deactivation decreases much more pronouncedly. And therefore, if we take what we call a performance ratio, which is the ratio between the desired rate dehydrogenation over the undesired deactivation, we see that this performance ratio increases as a function of hydrogen to hydrocarbon feed ratio. Therefore, from the point of view of performance of the catalyst, you would like to operate at high hydrogen to hydrocarbon ratio. However, as I said at the beginning, the equilibrium conversion is going to be affected. But most importantly, the economic of the process is strongly affected. For example, to illustrate this, I have some numbers that we have estimated for one particular process concept that we develop at Sun, but it's general to any dehydrogenation process. When we increase the hydrogen to hydrocarbon ratio from 0.5 to 2, the capital cost, in this case we referred only to the battery limits of the plant, it goes in this case from $60 to $90 million. And this tremendous variation in capital is particularly due to an increase in compressor capacities and exchangers and also separation units. So from the economic point of view, there is an important incentive to decrease the sensitivity of these cartilages to hydrogen. We have found a family of cartilages that respond to this idea of working at lower hydrogen to hydrocarbon ratio. These cartilages are sulfided nickel cartilages. This is different what Terry Baker was saying this morning. We are not putting a little sulfur, we put a lot of sulfur. These are heavily sulfided cartilages. And then I'm going to describe what's the reason for that. These cartilages have to be supported on non-acidic support. Particularly, we use cesium-treated alumina. Otherwise, the rate of pore formation is very high. This particular cartilage then has a very significantly different behavior in comparison to platinum. First of all, the rate of dehydrogenation is zero order in hydrogen and first order in the isobutane. And the rate of deactivation at a constant conversion is essentially constant over a large range hydrogen to hydrocarbon ratio and only increases when we are working essentially with pure isobutane in the field. Therefore, if we take our performance ratio as we defined it before, we're going to have a maximum at about 0.3 or 0.5, very low hydrogen to hydrocarbon ratio. We tried to explain this unique behavior of these cartilages in terms of the nature of the coke that is formed on these cartilages and also the type of different mechanism of reaction that should occur here. For example, when we look what is the effect of sulfur on this cartilage, if we start with an unsulfided nickel cartilage, the rate of hydrogenolysis and also rate of coke formation on this cartilage is very high. And at the conditions of our reaction, which is a hydrogen to hydrocarbon ratio of 0.5 and 600 degrees temperature, we only obtain methane and a very rapid rate of coke formation. And only when we heavily sulfide the cartilage, these two undesired reactions go down. And at that point, the dehydrogenation reaction increases, and we obtain a selectivity of 90% and above. The fact that coke formation is several orders of magnitude lower than on the unsulfided cartilage doesn't mean that coke is not formed. Actually, coke is formed, and we believe that is the main responsible for both activation of the cartilage that we're going to show now, and also deactivation. We found that the responsible for the coke formation is the product, the isobutylene, and this can be inferred from the observed coke profiles in a cartilage bed, in a fixed bed reactor. We observed that during 10 hours on a stream, the amount of carbon increases towards the outlet, more or less following the profile, concentration profile of the product. And also, by measuring the kinetics of coke formation as a function of concentration of isobutylene, we observe that it's essentially the rate of coke formation is essentially first order in the concentration of isobutylene. At the same time, when we did the same with pure isobutane, working at very low conversions, which is to minimize the concentration of isobutylene, the rate that we obtained at that point was 200 times lower. So we know what is the cause of coke. Let's try to see what is the effect of this coke deposition on the dehydrogenation activity. We observe that as the reaction proceeds and carbon starts being deposited slowly on the surface, we initially observe an induction period. I hope that Terry Baker is in the audience, so we're going to discuss it. He observed something like that on the sulfided cobalt cartilage in this case. We also observe an induction period that reaches a maximum at around 3% carbon. Let's keep that number in mind. And then after that, a slow deactivation process starts. We have tried to understand this by doing a characterization of the coke deposit. For example, by thermal analysis of the process of burning of the carbon deposit, we have observed exotherms at around 450 and 580 degrees C in this particular case. And from the area under this curve, we can calculate the amount of heat that is evolved during the burning. and then calculate this amount of heat as a function of the number of moles that have been burned. We observe that that heat varies with the amount of carbon on the surface. For example, when the amount of carbon the car is larger than 5 or 6%, this heat is around 90 kcal per mole, which is the same heat of combustion of graphite. On the other hand, but for much lower amount of carbon, like 2%, this heat is significantly higher, indicating that now either the carbon is a different chemical state or there is some hydrogen associated with carbon, and therefore when we ratio to the amount of carbon being burned, the evolution of water provides a extra heat. We are going to show that actually both conditions occur. In agreement with this thermal analysis, we observe that in the catalyst that contains large amount of carbon, there is a clear peak of graphite. So from both our thermal analysis and X-ray diffraction, we know that the catalyst that heavily coke contains graphite. And also by XPS, we have analyzed the species on the surface, on the coke catalyst. And we observe that in the case of the heavily coked catalyst, only one carbon state is dominant, which corresponds to the graphitic carbon. But when we have a small amount of carbon on the surface, we clearly observe two carbon states, one that can be ascribed to carbidic carbon, and the other with carbon containing some hydrogen, such as CH2, for example. Let me show you. We have studied the morphology of these carbon deposits by electron microscopy. And when we have a heavily coked catalyst, we observe the type of filamentous morphology that is typically observed in nickel catalyst. We observe two types of filaments. One is this tubular type, again with the catalyst at the end. And we also observe what they call, Rostrup Nielsen named octopus carbon, that this from one growth, one structure, we observe several branches. That we're going to discuss a little bit about that later. But combining these results with probe results, we can say that this would be the graphitic carbon that we observe by the thermal analysis and by X-ray diffraction. And the other type of carbon, the carbidic, and the carbon containing some hydrogen will be associated with metal. Thank you. It's okay. Finally, by temperature programmed oxidation of the carbon deposits, we've been able to quantify these different states that we observe by these characterization techniques. And if we look at the TPO profiles as a function of the carbon deposit on the catalyst, we observe, in good agreement with the previous techniques, that when there is a small amount of carbon on the surface, we observe two clear oxidation states. The low temperature one dominating when the amount of carbon is low. And as the amount of carbon increases, this low temperature peak seems to saturate, and then the high temperature peak keeps increasing, and when we have about 15% carbon on the catalyst, this is one dominant feature, which we can now correlate to these graphitic filaments that we observe by the other techniques. We have done a fitting of these TPO profiles, assuming constant concentration of oxygen and first order kinetics with respect to the amount of carbon on the surface. And we have obtained a nice fitting. And from that, we can calculate, quantify the amount of carbon in each of the states that we just mentioned. For two states having an activation energy of 45 kcal per mole, the low temperature peak, and a 52 kcal per mole, for the high temperature, more refractory peak, we observe that when the amount of carbon is small, the more reactive carbon, let's call it, dominates. Both increase up to about 3%. Remember that that is coincidental when we observe the maximum activity in dehydrogenation. At that point, this more reactive carbon saturates, and we only have now the growth of the more refractory carbon, which we'll say now is the formation of the carbon filaments. At the same time, we have also looked at the amount of water being produced during the temperature param oxidation of the carbon deposits, which can tell us if there is some hydrogen associated with the carbon. We can see immediately that the high temperature peak that we observe around 600 degrees was pure carbon. There was no hydrogen associated with it. And there is a small amount of hydrogen that is associated with the much reactive carbon. Well, this is in good agreement with our XPS data that shows that there is some hydrogenated carbon together with the carbidic carbon. We have also studied the reactivity of the carbon deposit with respect to hydrogen. This is important because this is what we're trying to look for, is a catalyst that is less sensitive to hydrogen than a typical platinum catalyst. And this can explain why our catalysts are so insensitive to hydrogen. We see that when we treat a catalyst that has 30% carbon in pure hydrogen in a temperature program reaction experiment, this one is a small peak of around 300 degrees, and then we need very high temperatures to produce any methane by gasification of the carbon. So we can see that although by the sulfidation of the catalyst, we have reduced the rate of co-formation very much. Now we have also reduced the gasification that serves in the case of platinum to clean the surface. So this explains why these catalysts are so insensitive to hydrogen. There is not much to gain by increasing the hydrogen to hydrocarbon ratio in terms of the life of the catalyst. So we have this picture that summarizes our studies on the carbon deposits. We have proved that the carbon deposition is due to the decomposition, or at least is related to the concentration of isobutylene. After the decomposition of this olefin, carbon containing some hydrogen on the surface and also some carbidic carbon, as seen by XPS, occurs, and then, as proposed by many other authors, a diffusion into the bulk occurs. Therefore, when we have saturation of this carbide species, we start having precipitation of carbon at the rear of the particle, causing the formation of the observed filaments. Therefore, the observed deactivation of these catalysts is not due, as in the case of platinum, by covering of the surface, but rather the formation of this three-dimensional structure that eventually will plug the pores of the catalyst. We have demonstrated that that is the case by looking at the variation of the pore volume as a function of the amount of carbon that we deposit on the catalyst. We see that initially there is not a big change in the volume of the pores in the range 100 to 200 angstrom, and about 3% that we said at that point the filaments start growing. We observe a decrease in the pore volume in that region. At the same time, an increase in the small pore region. This could be described as we are start forming a carbon deposit inside the large pores. Now the effective diameter of these pores reduces. So eventually, when the amount of carbon reaches 30%, the whole structure collapses. Now, we have been able to increase the life of this catalyst by increasing the tolerance to coke. We just been able to move this curve towards a higher amount of carbon. This is simply done by increasing the size of the pores. We have here the pore size distribution of our original catalyst, which has a pore volume of 0.65 cc per gram, and this pore size distribution with a maximum around 100 angstrom. By a method that involved the leaching with an organic acid and calcination, we've been able to move this size distribution around 50 angstrom, 250 to 200 angstrom. At the same time, the volume of the pores increased to 0.9 cc per gram. Now, this car is much more tolerant to coke. That means that can resist more coke and still have a high activity. We can show this when we show the isobutylene yield as a function of time on the stream. We observe that the catalyst, this green point here, that had been adjusted by leaching with an organic acid, we have the same amount of nickel and the same characteristics in the part of the active species. The only thing we have changed is the pore structure of the support. We increase very much the life characteristics of the carbs. Well, if we go back to the question that we presented at the beginning, we have not only the problem of the activation, but we have to explain also this initial induction period. What is unique for this type of catalyst? If we compare the typical platinum catalyst, we only observe a deactivation and no induction period. One possible explanation would be that one of these carbons that we observe, carbidic for example, that there is a coincidence between when that species saturates and the maximum is reached here. So one thing would be that that species is an active species. The other explanation I like more is that by the process of forming this carbide species, we are creating sulfur vacancies, which is the same, that's why I mentioned that Terry Baker, that was the same explanation he put today. During the process of carbon deposition, we can be creating sulfur vacancies and therefore exposing active sites. And this would be that process. This idea has indeed been presented years ago by Takeuchi, also working with heavily sulfided nickel catalyst. He observed, for example, with an H2D2 probe reaction, there is essentially no activity initially, but when that surface is exposed to acetylene hydrogenation reaction, he observed an induction period in acetylene hydrogenation, and then after that induction period fast, he looked again at H2D2 reaction and now the activity is high. And his explanation is based on the creation of this type of coordinatively unsaturated species that are active in comparison to this fully saturated sulfide species that is inactive. So based on that idea, we can propose our catalytic cycle involving the absorption, first involving the induction period for the formation of the active species, then the absorption of the hydrocarbon on that coordinatively unsaturated site, the further dehydrogenation with evolution of hydrogen and desorption. Note that we don't include here the hydrogen in the same site of the hydrocarbon. This would be an explanation why we don't observe any effect, any inhibiting effect by hydrogen, which can be compared to the typically believed cycle for dehydrogenation on a platinum catalyst. In that case, hydrogen and isobutane both can absorb on the same site, and therefore here in the dehydrogenation rate expression, we have an inhibition by hydrogen. Okay, let me conclude by saying that this sulfide nickel catalyst exhibited a high selectivity for the reaction of isobutane dehydrogenation. It can be active for long reaction periods. We have been working up to 2 or 3 weeks on the stream. The very, very favorable characteristic that it shows is that that can operate at much lower hydrogen to hydrocarbon ratio than any other metal dehydrogenation catalyst. And can be made coke tolerant by adjusting the pore structure. And finally, the process of coke deposition plays an important role not only in the deactivation of the catalyst, but also in the induction period and activation of the catalyst. Thank you for your attention.
Just a couple of questions. First of all, you have indicated some yield of the order of 20% in isobutylene.
Could you tell us something more about conversion and selectivity to coke, what about? And the second question is related to this resistance to coke that catalysts can accept a large amount of coke. It means long period in the reactor before the regeneration. What about the system in the process that you are thinking to supply the heat of reaction?
Okay, what was the first question?
The first was about the selectivity that you get from the catalyst.
Okay, that's a easy question. The selectivity essentially is unchanged over the whole period. You start with very high selectivity. So even we're working in induction period, that induction period is only increasing conversion. At that point, selectivity is essentially 90%. And even when we have deactivation, there is no decrease in selectivity. This interesting thing is on the...
You mean 90 by mole or by weight?
By mole. There is an interesting feature there regarding the sulfur. If the catalyst is heavily sulfided before the reaction and treated with hydrogen, it can stay overnight and it still will have the same good selectivity in the next morning. But after the induction period, if we cut the hydrocarbon feed and we leave it overnight in hydrogen, now that surface is much more active and that starts losing sulfur. When we lose sulfur, you start forming islands of nickel. So the hydrogenolysis goes up, and the whole thing is regarding the process, I don't know if I can talk much about the process, but we are not considering the burning of the carbon as a source of heat. That's all I can say. I know that Joke is that's a good picture. There was another question regarding selectivity. To coke is very low, extremely low. I don't remember the number, but it's very low.
Yes.
I don't know if actually you will see Saskatchewan. Maybe partially you may have answered the question. My first question was, what about the stability of the catalyst? You have hydrogen in the system, and you have sulfur in there. So there is some possibility of H2O formation, losing sulfur that way. So, does the catalyst have a long life, or do you have to introduce sulfur, for example, intermittently or something like that?
No, let me show you, if you give me the opportunity to show something.
Put it up a little higher, squeeze in the back. No. Right here.
Oh, okay. Here we have several regeneration processes. Well, we sulfide at the beginning, and we don't add further sulfur. However, if we do a regeneration here by burning slowly overnight at 400 degrees, we have to then resulfide again. When we resulfide, we again have this, the induction period. But we more or less regain the same activity.
Yeah, the second question was about the regeneration. You
have to resulfide, yeah. During the oxidation, you lose all the sulfur.
Yes.
I'm Raj from University of Louisville. You have compared with the activity with the monometallic platinum with the nickel sulfide. How about the bimetallic platinum catalyst? How do you compare with the bimetallic activity of bimetallic catalyst?
I didn't compare the activities.
No, how do you compare those values?
Yeah, I know. I mean, I didn't compare the activity. What I was comparing is the sensitivity to hydrogen. Yeah, that's a good point. Again, the effect of tin, for example, in the bimetallic platinum tin, is to facilitate the process of cleaning the surface. So what has been proposed there is that when you have tin, you have a more hydrogenated coke deposit, so the pore can be more easily reduced. But again, you may need less hydrogen there. That's true. That's a good point. But still you need hydrogen to clean the surface.
My next question is, carbon is supposed to be apparently a good catalyst for the dehydrogenation of paraffins. Do you think that the carbon deposited level catalyst is also contributing to the dehydrogenation activity? And from the induction period, it looks as if that as soon as 2% carbon is deposited, there is an increase in activity. And after that, it decreases.
Yeah. That's, again, that I said there are two alternatives, right? I like more the second one. You may ask Vince, maybe he likes more the first one. The thing is that the effect is too big. I mean, if you are considering that carbon plays a role, carbon can play a role as a hydrogen acceptor, right? But carbon should be much more effective than nickel or sulfur in this case to be such a tremendous effect. We have like four times more activity with carbon than without carbon. But consider that by the point that you put 2 or 3%, you're putting 1-to-1 carbon to nickel. So that means that the whole nickel sulfide particle has been penetrated by carbon. So what does this do to the morphology of the particle? It's a lot. It's not a little amount of carbon. From the point of view of the morphology of the nickel sulfide, it's a big damage.
We have done many control experiments using carbon as a catalyst.
We haven't done, but there is work by Fujimoto, for example. He has used activated carbons. And he, for example, when you have iron on activated carbon, it's much more active than iron on silica, for example. And he explained that the way you are explaining.
Can you give us an idea of how a process based on this catalyst could operate? How have you certainly thought?
Well, we have set up. You can operate by providing heat continuously. I don't know if you know the star process for something, or the Olaplex process. That could be another alternative. You can operate with alternative beds, dehydrogenation, of course the temperature goes down, you have intermediate heating, and you have another bed of dehydrogenation and intermediate heating. That would be one alternative. Another alternative is...
The regeneration of the catalyst. These processes you mentioned have a continuous
regeneration. That's continuous, right. But now here you can work for 2 or 3 weeks without regeneration.
Industrially, 2 or 3 weeks.
What?
Industrially, you need years.
No. You know the dehydrogenation process, he knows me. Catofin, for example, 8 minutes, that's the cycle.
Yes, but then they can burn the carbon deposited on the catalyst, provide the heat, and they don't have sulfur, because your sulfur is going to come up as SO2 or SO3. So it creates a big problem to a process, to an industrial process, I mean.
Yeah.
Other questions? Thank you very much.